Shamps and giggles, history, news, views, and reviews from a black perspective. Shamps and giggles back for 2024.
Oh, wow. The rain is just been torrential. Was it all week, 2 weeks?
Torrential.
That's when you know if you've got a good reef, good roof.
Yeah.
Oh, the building I'm working on in Houston, you know the pointing?
Yeah.
So it's raining and it's coming through the actual, the cement that separates the bricks is called pointing. It's actually through there into the building. Come on now. Wow. The rain just pours. It's England, yeah? It's England. It's that time of year. Or maybe not, because the summer's not been that hot. By the way, welcome one and all. Another fabulous moment, time. I don't know what you want to call it. We're Shabs and Giggles. We're here, the full crew. We're going to be talking to things. We've got so much to talk about. Time is running rapid, I'm telling you. Where are we in the time of year now?
Yeah.
I mean, gosh. You know what I mean? For me, summer, it's like summer was there, but it's like I didn't see summer. It wasn't a normal summer. That's the truth. It just wasn't a normal summer. It came and went, everything happened, but it was a strange one. It was a sad summer, but it was also a beautiful summer. You couldn't make it up. I mean, you couldn't have, I don't know, it was a hard summer. Trying to get back into the swing of things. And I'm very, very grateful for Shamps and Giggles because this is a huge help. Consistency, you need to have, a routine. This routine that we have developed. And of course, all the things that shoot off it is just amazing. That really, really, that helped you get back on your feet. Wait now, that helped you get back on your feet. Leisha, your hand's gone up. Nobody asked any questions, but part of the things, what are you telling me?
Routine and consistency.
Yeah. And the consistency. Just as we was talking there regarding, she's ever so Miss Shirley, but just as we was talking, you just get to realize that the time we spend together, it's meaningful. You know, when you start to divulge, like, you know, what we've done together, how we've been together, how we've seen each other through and all these, you're like, we've done all that. You know, and that's routine and consistency. And it's just building, it's continually building, which is amazing. Which is looking back on the pictures there of Shirley and the events that we've shared and so on and so forth. I mean, come on. Yeah, it's just been great. But what's in the news, Keith? What's the banter? What's been going on? Whole week's gone by.
What I'll do is welcome everybody, welcome radio listeners. It's usually we start with the condolence side of things, which, you know, there's been a few. So I'm going to start with the really sad, tragic news of a 15-year-old boy. A 15-year-old boy who got stabbed over the weekend in East London, Woolwich side. And they believe now it was a zombie knife, which, saying that now, they've now banned the sale of all zombie knives from last week. I think it was on Sunday it must have been this week, like Monday or Tuesday. The total ban of zombie knife in the UK is now totally banned.
I mean, any knife will do the same job.
Yes, but the zombie knives, they believe, is the ones that, is doing the most damage. And the most of the teenagers and young adults, they own one of those, or they've been purchasing those with serrated edges and... So they're now totally banned. No shops can sell them.
Sad, isn't it? Sad. I mean, to obtain one, what are you going to do with it? I mean, you think about it. What, you're going to take this and Chuck it inside. But you know what? There's no mindset, you know, amongst them, their youth there. The mindset is just way off. You can't make this stuff up. What area did you say that was?
That was in Southeast London, Woolwich area. And that is that the young child or young lad that passed away. Yeah, it's Dujon Campbell. You know, 15. And he died in that's it. That's the one. That's him.
That's a way of spelling a name. Dejon.
Yeah.
What, how did you pronounce the name?
Dujon.
Dujon.
Yeah.
He was stabbed with a zombie knife.
That's what they believe, yeah. It's probably because the injury looks the shape of. You know? So, it really, really sad. So,
a second man in his 50s who was arrested was charged. Also, an 18-year-old boy did it. Jacob Lozywicz. 18. That sounds like a Polish young lad.
See? Yeah.
Wow. So yeah, as you
understand,
yeah, a ban on owning zombie-style knives and machetes came on Tuesday, 2 days after the stabbing.
Yeah.
These not zombie knives. They look like those that you find in these computer games.
There you go.
Combat games. Yeah, if you see them, they're very, very lethal. Jagged edges, edges. So if you were to pull up, if you Google zombie knife, you'll see how.
It's a horrible knife. It's a horrible.
Yeah. But don't put it up though, because it's gonna. Don't put it on a screen, because it's gonna go on YouTube. So yeah, they don't like images like that.
On YouTube, know what a zombie knife look at, but and they show it on the news.
Yeah.
But think about it. I mean, it's a despicable, disgusting. I mean, it is designed, but you know, this is what it shows you, right? They ban the knife, but they don't ban the video game where these children are learning to use these knives. Yeah.
Yeah. I think they're trying to get the YouTube channels and these social media to try and take ownership of what they're allowing to come through their networks. You know.
But these knives, duck inside, you're definitely finished. But these video games, this is why these youth them are so barefaced. They practice for hours on end, days, weeks, and months, stabbing people in a video game. So of course, when they go on street, they've had the training.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, for the government to ban the knife and not ban the game that's teaching them how to use the knife, it don't make no sense.
Yeah.
And of course, you can tie in the increase in stabbing with the type of video games that has been introduced. Because obviously, this stabbing business is at an all-time high.
Yeah, it is. It is. And
it's at an all-time high.
Yeah.
What games are these children playing? Games where people are stabbing each other all the time. They can't
I think there is some element of the video games causing this pandemic, but the other part of it is when they're joining these gangs and their peers are doing it and getting away with it. So, you know, and they believe, well, I can do the same and get away with it.
Get caught. Well, the thing about it, the police are overwhelmed.
Yeah, they are.
You know, and you know, investigating these type of things is hard work. There's a lot.
It is hard work because no one wants to talk. Right. You know, no one wants to talk.
Right, so, and you know that. Right.
Yeah, and it is difficult.
You know, to actually get a solid case, you have to have a witness. There's so many elements to it. Lisha, you've got your hand out. You can chime in. There's so many elements to it. It's a lot of work. You know, even if they catch them on camera. On camera is helpful. Lisha?
Oh, sorry. I thought you were talking still. I was actually going to say about the worst hotspots for knife crime in England and Wales. It was the West Midland, which consists of Birmingham, Coventry, and Wolverhampton. It says that the high population density results in horrendously high knife crime rates of
Wow.
7 per 10,000 residents. And that is
Surprise.
in a website called The Conversation, which is about it's a charitable website. So yeah, you go to theconversation.com and you'll find out a bit more information about politics and the environment.
Yeah, personally, I don't want to find out more about it, to be fair. Oh, look, yeah, London. Oh, look, somebody from Birmingham has turned around and said, yeah, London is known for the, what's it say, shooting.
Shootings.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought we'd do condolences to the young lad that had lost
Yeah,
his life, you know?
Dejan. And his family,
Yeah, and
immediately.
his family.
Family
Yeah.
are just turmoil now.
Yeah. And
It's not.
the neighbor, and sorry, someone living on the road that he passed away on, went out, tried to stem the flow of blood, and he was still alive. And he said to them, and it's documented in the news, he said, "I am 15. I don't want to die."
Course not.
And that was his last words to the lady or the person, male or female. But yeah, I'm 15. I do not want to die.
Got my whole life ahead of me. That's
Yeah.
right. He's got
Yeah.
his whole life ahead of him. 15, not left school yet.
Yeah.
I mean, really, you haven't done anything yet. 15.
No, it's so
But you know,
sad. So,
you can't tell him. You tell someone,
yeah.
I don't go outside because them, they're fools. They're not listening. They're running out the
No,
door. You can't
no.
tell him. And then this happens, and then now you know.
Yeah.
We're in a what's it's a paradox, isn't it? What's happening out there? As parents, how can you protect your children from what's happening out there? It's a paradox. Is the government doing enough? Are the police doing enough?
Yeah,
I
well,
think.
they've put it on the Mayor of London's lap to say it's under his watch. Although the police are trying to whatever, but they're saying it's to do with the Mayor of London. So
Well,
I don't
it
know. They'll have to get their heads together and get it sorted out. There's a lot of community specialists out there that are trying to talk to the youth around London, and I'm saying this goes for not just London, throughout the UK,
Well,
trying to try and talk to the teenage community, so they're doing what they have to can do, but it still seems like they're 2 or 5 steps behind. You know, it was really sad. So I thought that we'll give our condolences to his family as our
yeah.
usual on our show. The other one, this goes out worldwide, really, and this is going out. I think that the toll number's gone right up now. Is to the Israeli strikes in Israel, you know, when
Oh.
with the with you know with the it was 274 people that died
Right.
with the Israel strikes, and this so-called mobile explosions. Some people had these pagers, sort of like phones, and they
Now,
put
Keith, hey, wait. Let's
oh.
break that one down because I can't get my head around.
No.
Have you listened on in on that story?
A
The
little bit, but
a
go
little.
ahead.
Well, I haven't listened. I thought you was going to bring up speed because
Yeah.
somehow they managed to turn
That's
a pager,
correct.
a walkie-talkie into a bomb,
Yes.
and
So
it blew up on tons of people.
that's correct. So these walkie-talkie stroke pagers, you can answer it. Yeah. So it's like a little
It's a
mobile
pager.
phone. So what's happened is that somehow the so-called terrorists or the Hezbollahis or someone like that infiltrated or got a batch of these walkie-talkies and mobile phones or whatever you want to call it. They inserted explosive devices in them. So somebody has got all these shipment container loads of them,
Right.
adapted them,
Right.
and then resold it into that
The bomb.
area's network or community. Anyone can buy it. Kids, whatever. It's a mobile phone, whatever. And what they've done, they've decided on a particular day
Right.
they were going to ring the phone. And that
Right.
is all it took.
Wow.
Ring that phone.
Wow.
As soon as you press the answer,
Boom.
yeah.
Because I saw a man with fingers. Oh, I didn't want to.
Kids, young youths, anyone, young ladies, everybody.
Unbelievable. Lisha, you know something about it?
No, I read up a bit about it, and what they and it, they said at least 32 people, including two children, were killed, unfortunately, and thousands more injured, more seriously after communication devices, they call them, some used by the armed group Hezbollah, dramatically exploded across Lebanon on Tuesday and Wednesday of this week. And it said that they also mentioned in this article that there were two firms accused by the media for manufacturing the pagers which exploded, were used explosives.
Right.
But both have denied responsibility. The Taiwanese and Hungarian companies, these companies are based in, and they say the governments are saying no, that the different parts of pages were not from their country. So, and also Japan as well, Japanese company, which apparently makes the walkie-talkies, said
Right.
it has stopped producing the model 10 years ago. Quite interesting.
So anyway, they still don't know about it. They don't know what really happened.
Well,
Shame.
it sounds as though the pagers have been adapted so that when it goes off at a particular time, it would explode. And these individuals probably had these pagers, and it just blew up. And unfortunately, it killed and injured many people.
Thousands.
The British government have said to all British nationals to come back, leave
Well, there is.
because of this.
Yeah,
Yeah,
that's right.
that's the
That's
paper.
it. That's it, Joe. Yeah.
So you got a pager on your hip. If that decides to go boop, 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 boom, that's your whole hip replacement. That's you're done.
Yeah. Well, the hospitals and doctors are saying. The medical profession said they've never seen so much horrific injuries and dismemberment of body parts
Yeah.
because of that particular device. And they're saying hips, legs, bottom torso's gone. When people have held it to their face, ears have gone, heads have gone. Neck. Yeah, it's really, really, yeah. Whoever thought of that way of maiming and killing people. They knew what they were doing. They knew the level of injuries and killing it will happen. Yeah.
Could not get my head around that.
Yeah. So,
I could not get my head around that.
no, it's really, really sad.
I still don't know. They don't know the details of, they're still trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
You know. Well,
So I thought I'd bring that as we do, bring our condolences. The other condolence I had, which is probably the last one, is the sad, sad news that we heard today of Dame Maggie Smith, a formidable star, lots of programs, films, great actress, Downton Abbey mother, matriarch, you know.
she'd been acting from morning.
Yeah, she was in Harry Potter's films, you know. She's covered the screen and 89 years old. She's just shy of her 90th birthday.
Joyful, huh?
Yeah.
You know, she got far.
She had breast cancer, I understand. So it is possible that it was stage 4, maybe, but very, very sad.
You know, they continue. They sometimes you can't even log into a page now without them offering you all kind of stuff that you have to
BBC's got it. The BBC, if you go to the BBC, they've got it. You don't have to accept anything.
Maggie Smith.
Yeah.
So it's very, I mean, she's been around for such a long time. As soon as you see the face, you absolutely know who she is, no two ways about it. She's been acting from morning.
Yeah,
I was looking
absolutely.
here, defining movies, when she was very young, but allow me in. You're suggesting the BBC, but I'm not seeing the BBC. This is it. Oh, BBC News on YouTube. Yeah, it's one of those things. But she lived a good long life. At
Oh
least she,
gosh, yeah.
know, and we'd all be happy. How much? 81 or 89?
89, 89.
89.
Yeah.
You know, you can't be upset with that, you know. I don't think she was upset with that. Oh Lord, I died now.
No,
Yeah,
she
it
done
was.
very, 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 very well. Very, very well.
Let's have a listen as we give tribute.
It's to that story that has emerged over the last hour or so. The multi-award-winning actress Dame Maggie Smith has died at the age of 89. She was known recently for her roles in the Harry Potter films and in the period drama Downton Abbey. She won countless awards, including an Oscar for her performance as the prime of Miss Jean Brodie. Her children released a statement saying she passed away peacefully in hospital this morning. Despite her profession, her family describe her as an intensely private person. Well, before we hear.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, been acting from white. Then black. She was there in the black and white movies, much less. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
But
Yeah.
she's been acting from morning. So she's really well. And well, I mean, may she rest in peace.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
So that's all the condolences.
Yep. There was a couple of good ones that's come out in the news as well. There was a lady who was the first ever black female Olympian. She received an MBE just the other day. She's 74.
Whoa.
Yeah, Anita Neal. Anita Neal, NEIL, ladies and gentlemen. She's 74. She got an MBE in recognition for her services to athletics.
Neil.
And yeah, Anita Neal. She was the first black woman to compete for Great Britain at the Olympic Games. And that was in 1968 in Mexico.
Oh, and I spelled this wrong. I saw an Anita K. It can't be right one. Neil, NIEL.
Yeah, NIEL. Yeah, Anita. NANITA.
Neil, yeah.
Yeah.
One word or two words?
One L. Yeah. Anita Neal. First black, and that's the BBC News.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
Yeah, first black female Olympian. And she got an MBE just recently.
For that, yeah.
Yeah, Windsor Castle this Wednesday.
Yeah, there you are. Anita Neal Wellingbow,
Yes.
British first black. And by the way, this and it's good to mention, this can be found on YouTube. And it's good to give mention to those in our community that have done exceptionally well. To become an Olympic athlete takes an incredible amount of work
Yes.
and effort.
In
It's
1968, yes, absolutely. Because you know
yeah.
what was going on in 1968. So very difficult times.
Yeah, of course. And we've done some talks regarding those times and
Yes,
things
you have.
happening in community, the racism that was rife at the time. And that was around when Carnival had just started. Carnival started for a reason because black people needed or felt that strong need to come together. in light of all the activities that was going on, you know, with regard to the police, what they used to do. Remember the nigger hunting and yeah, doing all that, man. And you black people just victims for no reason.
Sure.
And under that climate, she becomes an Olympian. You
Yeah,
know.
absolutely.
So
And
somebody saw her star qualities.
yeah. You know, I was trying to see when she became an Olympian. I was trying to see if I could see what how old she was, but I cannot find out because she was a young girl. A young girl at that time. So she must have been brilliant.
16 years old.
She was 16.
Six. She became an international athlete at 16 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, and less she temp so funny thing is, this isn't the first mention of her. She's a hero pioneer at 18 in 1968. She was 18.
Wow.
And she was not recognized for over 50 years. But here she is at the age of 70. And since we're giving that congratulations to her, let's give her a little mention because it's important, isn't it? Not recognized for 50 years. Come on. I mean, seriously, that's what.
Mission at last for Britain's first black female Olympian. Anita Neal competed in both the 100-meter sprint and relay at Mexico in 1968 and at Munich in 1972. Until recently, she felt she'd been ignored by the sport she loved. Now, at the age of 70, she has been named as a hero pioneer. She told Ben Chapman her inspiring story.
Portsmouth. Britain's Olympic athletes warm up for Mexico the day before.
She was a young sprinter who enjoyed being first. But what Anita Neal didn't know then...
10.6! Can you believe it? I didn't know I could move that fast.
...was that no black woman had ever represented Britain at an Olympics before. An historic moment that's finally been recognised after 50 years.
It means that you do go down in history as being number one.
Which is always important to an athlete.
Absolutely. Competitiveness in me. Well, this is the title I wore in Mexico.
It was 1968 and Anita was just 18. Her speed was spotted at school and she qualified for the British team for Mexico City, where she would go on to witness another significant moment in black Olympic history.
It was so exciting. It was surreal. Most poignant was the black arm salute. They didn't have any trainers on. They wore black socks, which represented black poverty. And I myself didn't have a lot of money at all. I mean, we were really struggling as a family.
Did you identify with them?
Yes, in that respect.
Indeed, despite her medals, by her 20s, she couldn't afford to continue competing, and her achievements were largely forgotten until recent research by the British Olympic Association identified her as a pioneer.
I want to inspire black girls to get in sport or anything. And I think that's a great thing to do. Inspiration.
But for Anita, it is recognition that now means as much as her medals of the trail she blazed for black women all those years ago. Ben Chapman, ITV News, Northamptonshire.
Well, there you go. I mean, beautiful, right? Beautiful. You know, 50 years. Look what they took away from her, not recognizing her for 50 years. There you go.
And I didn't realize that she's saying that when she got to 20, couldn't afford much, so she'd had to leave the sports. And I know time's upon us now. I just got the information. Commercial is due.
As is I. And what we're going to do is we're going to respect the time. We're going to go to break and We're going to play a tune, and you know what we'll do? We'll be back after these words. How do we push that button?